Hi, this is Rich. And this isn't really a regular video. It's just Ogvila and I are sitting here talking about souls and soul traps and how can a soul get trapped if it's not matter and all that. And so we were just sitting here talking. So you guys can listen in if you want. And I don't know. Should we go over any of what I just said to you? Guys, just explaining it, some of the understanding I have about the subject. So what's the issue? What's this guy basically saying?
That soul trap is a lie because it's made out of matter, and you can't, and soul is not a matter, so you can't trap the soul.
Oh yeah. It's kind of a little bit of aggressive kind of, like, hey, come on with the fucking soul trap thing already. How, souls aren't made out of matter. So you can't trap a soul, right? It's kind of like that. Mm. Yeah. Kind of pissed me the fuck off. I mean, hey, if you have a question about it, yeah, man, you know. But that's okay. Anyway, do you mind me repeating some of the stuff I said? And you can share your thoughts, too. If you're saying that there's no such thing as a soul trap, great. Don't believe it. Come up with your own fucking YouTube channel and fucking make videos about it, motherfucker. There's too much evidence that souls live on, but it's a label. You're talking about a soul. You're talking about a spirit, a soul. You're talking about you, the being that you are, living on after the body dies. And when we die, or when we move on, we're moving on either in a, ideally, people would like to think that they live on as a viewpoint, a point of awareness, so they are being the awareness that they are. That's a whole Eckhart Tolle thing, you know. You're being the awareness, not the person. So if you're being a person, you're involved with your mental stuff and your mind and your subconscious mind, your persona, your personality, the ego, the self that you believe yourself to be and you think you are. This beingness is what normally people leave with. They leave a lot of the crazies behind, the crazy beliefs and stuff that have to do with physical survival issues, worries and concerns about food and money and health and all that stuff. But normally, people in their afterlife, or from all these books I have on astral projection, what it's like in the astral planes and the other realms and between lives and afterlife and all that stuff. Most people are telling the same basic story. We live on. We have a body, and it's usually kind of like ours, the one you have here, maybe younger or better looking or a tweak here and there, but not always. But this is you carrying on in another plane of existence. It's not matter. It's not, by the word, this guy's saying, how can a soul be trapped by matter? Well, it's not a universe of the matter, energy, space, and time of the physical universe. It's different. So when you're over there, like in fourth density reality, or if you're in the astral plane, you can walk down the street and there's trees and there's a stream and there's pretty flowers and there's all kinds of wonderful stuff. Or it can be real creepy. But it's a world and you're in it. And depending on which realm you're in and your own mindset, you can walk through the walls or you can fly. But depending on the realm or your mindset, you can't walk through the wall. You can try to push the wall real hard and you can't. You try to fly and it ain't working. But it has to do with the spiritual mindset of the being when they leave here or before they got here, wherever they are in this multiverse. And so when this guy goes on, it sounds like me as basically a verbal attack, really. You know, he just, hey, come on with the fucking soul traps already. Sounds more like to me he was afraid, triggered his fear. Oh, what if that's true? He couldn't handle it, kind of a denial sort of thing. That's what I think. And hey, everybody leaves here, they're not going to run into a soul trap. Not by a long shot. Everybody's got their own thing. But if you want some some insurance or some reassurance or assurance that that sort of thing will not happen to you when you cross over, this next time you cross over, whether you know you drop dead today or next week or 100 years from now, when this body expires, you live on. Now, is that a soul? Is that the soul that lives on? It depends on which teachings you're talking about. There's the awareness, and the awareness has an idea, a mental construct of who and what it is. And this is what it is. Now, by default, most people, when they drop dead, they're in an astral body or a second body, an energy body sort of thing. Robert Monroe talks all about this in his books, Journey Out of Body and all this stuff. But, you know, I've been over there many, many times. You know, I'm just like, wow, this is amazing. And it's very, very real. I mean, it's more real than here. And I've been over there running around, and I've gotten caught or trapped, not in a soul trap sort of way, like a spirit flying around in outer space and getting caught. That can happen too. But, you know, you can get, you know, cornered in a room and you can't get out. And, you know, is this, are you being a soul and talking about a soul trap? No. You're in an astral plane somewhere, or you're some other alternate reality, and some of the bad guys are chasing you down. They kind of got you cornered in a warehouse or something. So it just goes all over the fucking place. But I think this particular viewer was watching one of our videos about soul traps. There was that remote viewing that was done by the Farsight Institute. And they specifically focused on what happens to a being or person after they die. And so that person, we're talking person, personhood, personal identity, it's the consciousness that is identifying with the person that they believe themselves to be. So it takes consciousness and the awareness in all that is, and everybody is awareness. There's no difference in that. But in these different points of view over millions of years or hundreds of lifetimes or thousands or whatever, the beingness assumed by awareness becoming the person or the soul, because we're not talking about the body, that soul is now accumulating experience. And through the accumulation of experience, it accumulates emotional trauma, pain, worries, fears. Terrible fucking bad things have happened to this being over many, many years. Lost loved ones and torture, and flip it around, and the beingness that we are has done the bad things to others. And then we bury that. Now we got karmic law, and what is that? And it's just balance and stuff. But do we call this a soul? Do we call it a person? And this person or the soul, or which is really the awareness identifying with its experience and thoughts about the idea of it being a self or itself. And with this comes all this mental machinery and action and reaction, stimulus response mechanisms, and then we see something that scared us 1,000 years ago, and the same, and it just triggers our shit, and we're now afraid, and we don't know why, like fear of falling or fear of heights or something. It doesn't matter. Fear of snakes is a, why is that person not, and this one is? Well, this person may have got eaten by a giant snake, terrible in terrible ways. And trigger. But this idea of a self with a mind and a memory that's all subconscious but affecting us in the now, is this the soul we're talking about? If that's what we're talking about as a fucking soul, it's just a goddamn label. This being, this awareness that is being the point of view with all this stuff going on, is susceptible to being trapped. Trapped literally and basically, fundamentally, by his own beliefs that he can be. So it sounds simple, you know, just stop believing you can be trapped and you can't. Essentially, basically, that's how it works. But we've got a lot of lot of history, a lot of baggage, and we've got to be able to sort through that, sort that out. And the best way to do it is just shine the light of consciousness on it. Just look at it. Oh, I see what I did 1,000 years ago. Oh, I made an agreement, you know, 10,000 years ago to experience the terrible things I did to others, just to balance it out. Because I was just, I don't know, I was just in a thing. I was going through a phase, and I was being the mean guy. I was being the bad boy. And I've done so many past life regression things that everybody, that if they've had it done to them, they've done it to others. Every time. I've never found a case that wasn't like that. So if you got the shit beat out of you and got tortured like crazy and you're, oh man, it was 10,000 years ago and you got brutalized and now you're all fucked up because of that, go back 100,000 years or somewhere in there, you were being the bad boy. Yeah. It's just the way it is. It's like somewhere along the line, this was like an online virtual reality game. And we get online, do virtual reality games, and you beat the shit out of things all the time. Innocent bystanders. When Grand Theft Auto first came out, it was just fun to run over people on the sidewalk. And then as the game progressed, people doing all kinds of crazy shit. It's fun to take on the, hey, I'm a thief. I steal shit. That's the thief franchise. Assassin Creed. Hey, I'm an assassin. I kill people. In this real physical universe where matter, touchy-feely, we get into these, when we can move in and out of bodies at will, this was like a virtual reality game. This is a no-brainer. This is fun. And you can take either side. And we didn't judge ourselves whether we were being bad if we were in a part of an assassin's guild or if we tortured things or blew shit up. It didn't bother us. But somewhere along the line, we got over-identified with the physical universe experience. And when we're here, we forget about, we don't realize what it's like out there, over there, beyond, outside the game. And now, when we get caught up in these ideas of do unto others as you would like others to do unto you, golden rule sort of stuff, and also a sense of balance. If I do it to you, you can do it to me. And it's like somebody likes to fight, and they get in and they punch the other guy in the face, and the guy doesn't punch back. That's fucked up. Come on, man, let's do this. I thought that was the game. You know, we're in the ring, and the guy's just nothing. It's very unsatisfying to the guy that's doing all the punching. He wants to get punched back. So there's more to it, but it's kind of similar like that if you're shooting people and killing people or blowing up planets as a game in game universe. But now it's not happening. Nobody's like coming back. And it's like, and so on a subconscious level, we attract that. We want it. We want the challenge. You want a game. If you bought a game today, PS4 game, you'd want a game with some good bosses, good boss fights. Not some wimpy fucking thing that, or a game where there's no dramatic interaction like that, no contention and no opposition. You know, there are those games out there, but they're not as popular as these fight games and hack and slash and challenge and save the world and blow bad things up and evil monsters and all that shit. So it's the nature of our beingness